Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the first of the Grime Z80 project videos that I'm going to be doing over the next few weeks. Now, if you're watching me on Patreon, they'll be posted every day. Otherwise, every week on a Wednesday, these will be posted to the internet, so hopefully you'll follow this series. Now, what is the series? Well, this game I'm playing here is called Grime. It's an old DOS game I remember from my childhood, and what I'm trying to do is I'm recreating this game onto the Z80. Now, what do I mean by the Z80? Well, I'm going to port this game in a way that the code can be compiled onto any one of 11 different Z80 systems. So this will be a common code base that can be recompiled and be played on a whole bunch of systems, pretty much all of the Z80 computers, to be honest. So let's take a look at the code then. I'll just kill myself here. And I'll close this. So, let's have a look at what I've done. So this is the day one video. I'm going to do a different video every day, and the project has to be completed within 7 days. So this is what the state of things after the first day. Now, the code is based on my tutorial. So what I've done is I've pulled in all of the tutorial code, fixed a few bugs, to be honest, and made a few tweaks and optimizations. And I've started building it into a way that I think I can work best with this game on all of these different systems, because I'm supporting all of these systems here. And even this is 10 of them, but I'm actually supporting the MSX1 and the MSX2, so this doesn't even represent them all. So let's see what I've actually done, and then we'll talk through it a little bit. So as you saw, the game basically is it's a text-based system on the original DOS machines, but from my point of view, I'm not going to use text. I'm actually using graphical sprites, and you can see them here. So what I've started by doing is drawing these tile sprites here. So each one's going to be 8 pixels wide and 8 pixels tall. And you can see the player is going to be a little spaceship. I've just got these little crude placeholders here because I didn't really want to worry about drawing things at this stage. So this blob is going to be the outer perimeter of the grime. The inner perimeter is going to be this blue stuff here, and the seekers are going to be this yellow star here. So potentially it's going to be a 16 color game, but some of the systems I'm going to be working in 4 color mode. The graphics mode I've chosen is going to be 256 by 192 on all systems where that graphics mode is possible. If it's not possible, I will reduce the size of the playing area, except for on the TI-83. On the TI-83, I'm going to use 4 pixel wide and 4 pixel tall sprites, because I think the TI screen's so small it wouldn't be playable if I didn't do that. So that's my plan. Now, as you can see, the example, the state of it today is I've just drawn these two sprites here on the screen, and so let's have a look at that. So we'll just skip over this code for now, and we'll have a look at that later. But you can see here there are two commands. There's a sprite number 4, which is this here. There's a location on the screen, 1, 1, and that is standardized across all the systems. So the top corner is 0, 0, but 1, 1 is the same, you just saw that on the SAM. But if I now terminate that and run that on the lowly TI-83 calculator, you can see there, the colors come out wrong, and that's because I've not worried about doing any optimization yet. These are just early sample sprites, but you can see when it's converted to 2 color, it does go to a blob there. But so you can see this does work on absolutely all of the systems. So that was the TI. Let's have a look at the spectrum. The spectrum's a 2 color system as well, but I am using color palettes. So you can see, I've not cleared the screen yet, but you can see the sprite is drawing and it's being colored in. And I've got some special code to do that, which I'll show you later. Now, on the Amstrad CPC and the Enterprise, the systems where the 16 color mode is low resolution, I thought it would be more appropriate to use the, I prefer the 4 color mode. And because I've not worried about a good palette yet, it's just coming in grayscale there. But the game does work on all of the systems in the same way. Now, how does it work? Well, as you can see, I've got this show tile function, which is a new function I'm working on. And this is the new function here. This is the simple tile function. The game could be done with sprites, hardware sprites on the systems that support them, but for simplicity, I don't think it's worth it. So I'm gonna do the entire game as a sort of grid tile-based system where everything is on an 8x8 pixel grid. So here's the code, the new code. So the tile widths here are the, are just being used to define how wide in bytes each tile is. Now this code here is basically mimicking my show bitmap code. I may well optimize this later. At the moment, I'm not worrying about speed. I was just worrying about compatibility. I wanted to get it working on all of the systems today. So this code is basically the same as the show bitmap code that I recently demonstrated in my tutorials. So not much to see here, but you'll notice there's some alternatives up here, and this is something a little bit more interesting. So you've got this show tile here, which is using a VDP parse. Well, what's that? Well, this is all about the Sega Master System and the Sega Game Gear. They both use the same graphic system, so I'm able to use the same functionality. And so what this does is it gets the memory location of the tile definition and the tile map, sorry, and then it sets the sprite number. Now I'm adding 128 because the letters A to Z and 0 to 9 are also tiles. So just to get out of the way of those, I started the graphical sprites at 128 within the hardware's sprite tile definitions. And I'm doing the same on the Game Boy here. Now the Game Boy, the tile array is memory mapped, but on the Game Gear and the Sega Master System, they are a separate device like the MSX, so I have to add them to these data ports here. Now there was one surprise today. As I say, I'm working on all of these systems, including the Game Gear and the Sega Master System. Now one thing that I wasn't ready for is this. I'll just show you it. So if I put in EXSP,HL and I compile this onto the Game Boy. Now you'll see it compiled fine here. I'll show you that. So there's no errors being mentioned here, but the Visual Boy, the emulator, which you can't see because of my screen size, is come up with this unknown opcode error. And what it is that the Game Boy isn't really a Z80, and it's got a lot of commands missing. And in all the other cases, VASM will not compile if it knows you're using a command you shouldn't be. But they've missed one. This command, it seems to think it can compile. It compiles it to the code, and then the Game Boy complains because it can't do it. Now, with regards to the Game Boy's more limited system, what I'm doing is I'm working within those limitations. I'm not using any of the registers that are missing. If you want to know about this, I've got a special Game Boy website I'm working on, which has a description, and I'll leave a link to that in the comments just so you can check it out. But the way I'm generally working around these limitations is, I'll show you this. I've got this file called Game Boy Z80 compatibility here. And you'll see within this, I've got a new command called EXSPHL. And this is a equivalent command, much larger, but an equivalent command that does the same job as this. So if I need to be able to do this command, but I'm doing it on the Game Boy, then I use this. And I've got a version, I've got a file called Z80 compatibility, which has these same macros, but then maps to the normal command. So on the Game Boy, I can use the command, the more efficient command on the Z80, but then the Game Boy version will automatically compile to this command. And as you can see, there's a lot of commands missing, and I've got substitutions already so that if I need them, I can use them. And I've even defined definitions of the missing registers just so I can use those as well, just because it makes my life easier. And I am going to need temporary variables, so, and sometimes push and pop may not be appropriate, so why not use them? Now, this is another thing with regards to the Game Gear as well. I'll just show you the Game Boy version. Better take that intentionally dodgy coder. I've already known it. So let's have a look. So here's the version on the Game Boy. Again, grey. The Game Boy Color version doesn't have any color yet, but I can assure you it does work. So I won't show you the Game Boy Color, but I will show you the Sega Master System. So there we go, green blobs again, looking exactly the same. And this is another thing to notice. I've not covered it in my tutorials yet, but it's coming. The palette definition, I'm using one common palette definition for all of the systems, even the four color systems. So, and that's why it's looking black and white in the four color systems, because it's only reading in these first four definitions here. And as you can see, they're all black and white, but it's all going to be fixed, but I just wanted to make the point I'm able to use a common palette definition because I have code that converts it to the hardware's requirements. So that's something that's quite nice. So you've just seen the Sega Master System. The Game Gear is actually the same hardware. The screen's just smaller, so I have to offset the sprites a little bit to get everything lined up. But basically, the code is the same, so that's quite nice. So yeah, the Game Gear and Sega Master System are a true Z80 processor. It's only the Game Boy I'm having to compensate for. Now, as well as these sprite display routines, or these tile display routines, probably more appropriate, I've been working on my monitor. I can now run my monitor from all the systems. This is my debugging monitor, I should say, not a screen monitor. So if I just start the Game Boy Color here, you'll see I've got the state of all the registers here. This was a little bit tricky because the Game Boy and the Game Gear and the systems like that, they only have a very limited amount of memory. They only have about 8 kilobytes of memory, and your program code is in ROM. And this is a bit of a change for me, because usually I use a lot of self-modifying code. I can't use self-modifying code when you're running in ROM. And also, you have to put all your variables in a common place. So you can see here, the key press buffer I've had to store in this game RAM plus 16, and then some. I've had to recompile and change my debuggers, my monitors, to not use self-modifying code and use sort of temporary memory instead. And I've got, that's what these ROM versions are. These are versions that don't use self-modifying code. And also I've had to rewrite some of the code to work within the Game Boy's limited CPU's capabilities. But as you can see here, I've got the same functionality as I always had. And I just press a key and then you can see the colors change and we go back to black and white. But as I say, this is all going to be fixed. The Game Boy, although it's a four color per tile system, it is actually capable of far more than four colors. So it's not going to be black and white. It's not even going to be close to black and white. Now, one other system that's quite fun, and this is something that's also going to be covered in my tutorial soon, is the MSX1. I wasn't planning on supporting the MSX1, but I had some time, did some work, and I managed to get it working. It doesn't work in a tile sprite based system like the other ones do. It can work in a bitmap system because it's got quite an advanced screen mode, but it has some heavy limitations on color, although they're not as limited as the lowly, I've got my monitor in the background there, as the lowly spectrum. Now you can see here I've got the blobs, and once again they're black and white, but if you look very closely you should see that at the top and the bottom there is a slight gradient effect. So it starts bright green in the middle, but then it gets darker green toward the edges. And the reason for this is, whereas on the spectrum I can only declare one color for the entire 8x8 tile, and I can show you here's my definition. So this definition is for sprite 1, 2, 3, and this is sprite 4, and the 4 here is green. And you can tell that if you look at my editor here, you can see there's a 4 there, which is green. Now, the MSX uses a different palette, and I don't have that to show you on screen, but here are the definitions here of the colors that I'm using. So this is sprite 1 here, and there's a different color for each line. So I can have a foreground and a background color that are different for each line. And so that's how I've been able to do that gradient effect. And maybe I can even do some nice detail within the blob and with different kinds of green. So I'm taking full advantage of the MSX1's color abilities, even though they are far more limited than a true 16 color system. But generally speaking, very similar. I'll just show you the code for that. So here's the simple tile function. This is the general bitmap plotting function, which works commonly on all systems, but then the ZX Spectrum has this two color module here that adds the color attribute, and there's just a single color attribute to apply. But the MSX1 has this more advanced one here where it reads in 8 bytes for each tile sprite and then sends them out to the VDP. And this getcolmempos and this getcolmempos have the same function in the sense they get the memory location, but obviously the memory locations are completely different and their functionality is different. We're gonna cover the MSX1 later in the tutorials, but at the moment, I'm just gonna not cover them. But of course, once this project is finished, whatever state it gets in, hopefully a playable game, the game will be free. You'll be able to download the game, and you'll also be able to download the source code. So I'm hoping this will make a nice template for people who want to play around with making their own multi-platform games, because you know, it's going to be simple, but it's going to be fun, hopefully. And it's going to have joystick control and have sound effects. So hopefully it will be a good starting point for people making their own little games. Okay, so well, apart from just showing those little sprites on the screen, I have done one other thing. I'll just rem this out here. I'll build this on the Amstrad CPC for a change. Now, what have I got here? Well, if you look at the FF in the top left-hand corner here, what that is that's a dump of the current state of the joystick and the keyboard. So I've defined two sets of controls, one on the joystick, and I'm pressing the buttons now, and you can see different bits in those bytes are changing as I do. And then if I press the keyboard, you can see the other side is changing. The game's only going to be in one player, but I thought it would be nice to have a default set of joystick controls and a default set of matching keyboard controls, because then I can OR the two together and get a definitive set of controls that I can just check if the player's using either of those systems. So I've now defined that for all of the systems, and how I've done that, if I just close this, and then if I... A lot of this is just test code at this stage, but if I just enable this compiler definition here and run it again, now you can see it says press a key for player one up, and if I press a key, and then I press a key, so I'm just pressing different keys here, it doesn't really matter what. And once I've pressed all the keys, it's now show that what you can see there is a memory dump of the resulting key map. And if I just scroll down to the bottom of the screen here, these are the correct key maps for nice keys on each system. And the keys I'm actually using are what is usually defined in this engine as player one is WSAD, BNM, and P for pause. And then on the joystick, it's up, down, left, right, fire one, fire two, if there is one, if there isn't, enter, space for fire three, which this game won't use, I don't think, but and then P for pause again. And so all of these systems have joysticks and keyboards, so I've got those definitions in. Then as for the Gameboy and Game Gear, well, they have their own built-in hardware joysticks, so I'll just directly read out from there. I've not covered this joystick routine, this joystick processing routine yet in my tutorials, but I will. It's going to be in there, and if you want in your own games, you could use that redefining keys as an option. For simplicity, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to hard code the keys because I don't think the game's complex enough to need keyboard redefinition. So just to keep everything as simple as possible, I'm going to take it out and just hard code it. But again, that's something you could do. So yep, that's the state of things today. I got some simple graphics on the screen. I've got joystick and keyboard working on all of the systems. I've got the Game Boy and the Game Gear and the Master System doing their graphics, because I had test code, but I was reasonably confident I could do it, but it wasn't in a state to just drop it in. So I'm quite happy with the progress on that. The MSX1 looks better than I expected, actually. Really impressed with the way that looks. So what am I going to do tomorrow? Well, I'm going to start working on the array. The game's going to have a grid of memory that's going to be used to define the current state of the game map, of the game area. And then it's going to update it for the next frame when the mold starts growing. And then it's going to be used both for drawing the screen and for the logical update. So I'm going to start defining that. I'm going to start drawing it to screen. And then based on how fast it is, I may have to reconsider things. This will also be the time I can start changing the TI-83 version. Because as I say, it's currently using 8x8 pixel, but I want to make it 4x4. So once I've got an array of data I can show, I can start doing that work. So there we go. Well, anyway, I hope you've enjoyed today's episode. I hope you'll stick around and follow the next one, which, as I say, if you're a Patreon, will be tomorrow. If you're just watch me on YouTube, then that'll be in a week's time. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.